there will be no end to this process of indulging in interest transactions. So this is why in Ahmadiyyat we advise very strongly not to permit yourself to deal in interest transactions unless economically, for the sake of the survival of your business, you are compelled to deal with this. And there, it is not just my word, it is the word of Hazrat Masih Maud alayhi salatu wasalam, that an Ahmadi businessman, when he is compelled to borrow money from banks, otherwise his business cannot survive, he has to pay back in terms of interest accrued by the bank, but this is something which you can't do away with. Or it will be a community suicide, economic suicide of the entire community.
Hazur, whenever a businessman takes money, he expects that the business will prosper. But many times transactions go sour.
Exactly, that's right. But if he borrows money without interest, will the rule applicable be a different rule?
Nobody will lend him money.
No, no. In Islamic system, we know many Ahmadis lend money to others without interest. Will that money be employed more wisely? So your objection remains the same. Your objection is that if somebody gets some money on loan and he loses that money, it does not always prosper, I mean this business. So what will happen? My more modified question is that if he gets some money without interest and he loses that money, then what would happen? Nothing. He loses the money of somebody else's. And that is equally applicable to the money of interest and money without interest. No difference. So one worry less if the interest of a usury a concern dealing in interest system is lost. I should say one worry less. But the concern would be if the money of somebody who has earned it rightfully is put to jeopardy by mishandling of a person who borrows and does not take proper care of the money. Do you follow what I am saying?
Yes. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So the question you have raised is irrelevant. Irrelevant to the issue, I mean. In a system, in an economic system where banks must play a role in shaping the economy, and where individuals are many a time compelled by economic necessity to borrow money from them, this is not exactly what the loaning out of money to poor people, helpless people, is. That is a different situation. So it is objectionable, of course, but less objectionable. And the gain, on the other hand, is more than your loss. It is economic survival of a community. As such, as I have earlier mentioned, sometimes even the haram is permitted under certain conditions, like the flesh of swine. Provided you are compelled to eat it, only to the degree where you must have it. To that extent, if the flesh of swine is halal, why can't the borrowing money from banks can be treated as such? Show me the difference. What is the difference? Here is the question of survival of the community. You know, once Hazrat Khalifatul Masih Awwal spoke on the issue of hundis and the international transactions, whereby this interest was always involved, you know, in that transaction. And Hazrat Khalifatul Masih Awwal gave an edict in favor of this on exactly the same reason which I am just suggesting. He said, for the economic survival of the community, this is a must. And you should not deal it absolutely freely, you know, relishing it and liking it, but whenever compelled, you should not hesitate to do that.
But Hazur, this businessman is not doing for the economic survival of the community, he is doing it for his own sake.
I know that, but they are all individuals. The community is composed of individuals. Each individual will do for himself, and the totality makes it a community. I mean, you can't differentiate between this and that. I never said, and nor did Masih Maud at any time, that all individuals who work for the sake of the Jamaat are permitted to deal with this. Where did I say, or where did Masih Maud say that? So why do you attribute things to us? We never said. What was said is that if a member of a society is forbidden to as totally, the whole society will choke economically. If each member is forbidden from certain transactions as illegal, and this belongs to that category, it's no longer a question of individuals, because every individual or a group or a society will be treated alike. And as a whole, it is not possible for them to survive, because it's not just an issue of usury. The other minor points also involved. And it will become impossible for you to distinguish between right and wrong if you go to such detail. You are employed by a bank, let's see. And the income which bank earns is halal or haram?
Well, under Islamic teaching is haram.
Haram, so yes. No bank employment.
Right.
You are employed by governments. The income earned by most governments is founded on system of usury. Some governments have sold all their assets in just servicing their debts, like South Americans. So all services of those governments will become haram, right?
Yeah, but the individual...
Right. Listen to me now. I have listened to your extended questions with such patience, now listen to me. Now, all the grocery shops indulge in some sort of haram, don't they? So any service there will be haram. Okay? And choose one business and another, one after the other, and show me one single business which, according to your concept of Islam, is pure and healthy and permissible and wholesome.
That's what I wanted to hear.
Okay?
Yes.
Thank you very much.
Assalamu alaikum, Hazur.
Yes, please.
My name is Sufyan Faruqi, and yes. My question is, after the Jummah khutbah, you always go down for a little pause while
I sit for a while, because that is what is reported of Hazrat Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He always did. After delivering his first khutbah, he always sat for a few moments and then stood up and then recited the khutbah, which we call khutbah masnoon. Now there is of course wisdom in everything he did. But the wisdom underlying in this is that the previous khutbah is not defined. You can say anything you like, addressing a community, concerning the requirement of that community or advices which you must render to the community. But the second khutbah is a defined khutbah. You can't change its wordings. So when he finished the first khutbah, then he sat and said, now these are the words which you must follow verbatim. And each word, as I am announcing, should be repeated. So if he had mixed things up, then you couldn't draw a line between the two. Right?
Yeah.
Thank you.
Jazakumullah.
Come. Would you like to drink?
No. Assalamualaikum. Assalamualaikum, Hazur.
Jazakumullah, thank you for reminding me. Yes. Yes, please. Assalamualaikum.
My question is, log kyun Hazur ka हज़रत ईसा